Hi, my name is Jane Wong. I am a poet, writer, and professor at Western Washington University up in Bellingham. I am the author of a book of poems, Overpour, and my second book of poems, How to Not Be Afraid of Everything, is coming out next year from Alice James Books. In addition to being a poet, I am also a restaurant baby. I grew up in a Chinese American takeout restaurant on the Jersey Shore, where my love of poetry and food immediately collided. I also had a show at the Fry Art Museum last year entitled After Preparing the Altar, the Ghosts Feast Feverishly. And in that show, I had sculptural food poems, thinking a lot about my family history with starvation, but also my upbringing with gluttony and the ways in which poetry deeply untangles these complicated lineages and sensory memories all related to food. And so today, I'm really excited to spend some time with you all thinking about writing deliciously, thinking about food and poetry together and the ways in which food in particular opens up evocative spaces for you to explore family, memory, lineage, and identity, and the ways in which your communities are nourished. And so I wanted to today to kind of, you know, at least start with, you know, this idea of nourishment, and that writing for me, poetry for me, is a type of nourishment and a type of healing as well. And I hope during this session you have literal nourishment around you. So if you haven't already, please go get some snacks, your favorite snacks, you know, some water, some tea near you as you write, so that you're able to feel nourished in your body as well as in the act of writing and creating. Today, my plan is to kind of walk us through some of, you know, writing from some of my favorite poets and writers, thinking about food and poetry together, and then offer you some sparks of thinking, in other words, some prompts to write with me. And I hope that you're able to maybe hit pause on the video and write for a bit. And usually I would suggest something about 10 minutes to kind of write through these prompts. And then you can come back to these poem starts later and add more and revise. I wanted to start today with a poem by the poet Liang Li called From Blossoms. And I'll go ahead and screen share that poem so you're able to read along with me. Again, this is called From Blossoms by Liang Li. From blossoms comes this brown paper bag of peaches we bought from the boy at the bend in the road where we turned towards signs painted peaches. From laden boughs, from hands, from sweet fellowship in the bins, comes nectar at the roadside. Succulent peaches we devour, dusty skin and all, comes the familiar dust of summer, dust we eat. Oh, to take what we love inside, to carry within us an orchard, to eat not only the skin, but the shade, not only the sugar, but the days. To hold the fruit in our hands, adore it, then bite into the round jubilance of peach. There are days we live as if death were nowhere in the background. From joy to joy to joy, from wing to wing, from blossom to blossom, to impossible blossom, to sweet impossible blossom. And in this poem, there's so much to say, of course, but what I love especially, even reading it out loud, is how this poem picks up its speed and rhythm towards the end, that moment of from wing to wing, from blossom, to impossible blossom, to sweet impossible blossom. It's almost kind of impossible to read out loud in a slow way. It generates so much energy. And in thinking about kind of food and energy and the ways in which food sustains us, both, you know, literally, but emotionally, I want us to take some time with a few lines that come before this passage, which is this kind of calling forth, the O to take what we love inside to carry within us an orchard. And there's something about this O, this kind of guttural noise, this kind of calling forth. It's kind of a moment in the poem that slows us down to think about this possibility of what we could do if we were able to carry within us an orchard, if we could take everything that we love, everything that nourishes us inside, what would that look like? What would an orchard of self look like? And I'll just stop share for a moment here and offer you a prompt inspired by Leon Lee's poem, thinking about that very question of a orchard within yourself. And so again, if you have paper and pen with you, or you can write this on your computer as well, I want you to write a litany poem. A litany poem is simply a list poem. And in many ways, a litany is a really helpful start for me as a poet, because sometimes I don't know what to write down. But when I write a list, it feels a lot easier to kind of get started this way. So in this way, I want us to think about what we would carry within us if we were an orchard. So I want you to write a list of all the foods that make you feel loved and safe. And I want you to write down all of those foods that make you feel loved. In this case, for Lee, that's going to be peaches, but I'm sure that he would add even more to that. And after you kind of write down this litany of food that makes you feel loved, I want you then to think about the sensory memories that arise when you think about these foods in particular. What are those sensory memories? Maybe it takes you back to a moment in childhood. Maybe it's tied to a specific person. And I want you to weave those memories into your list, into your litany poem. And maybe towards the end of your piece and your time writing, you might consider, what do you still need to feel full, right? That can be literal or abstract, but for this orchard to feel full, what else would you need? Maybe this poem is a type of invocation or an asking for all these things to keep yourself nourished and comfortable. So we'll take some time to write now. So you might want to pause for a moment and write again this litany, creating this orchard of the things that make you feel loved in a poem. I'll pause there just for a moment. Okay, we'll pick back up again, and I hope you had a fruitful time writing and that you maybe kind of went somewhere you didn't expect to go, which is part of what I love about poetry, is that there's always these little turns or voltas that take you somewhere else you might not even know that you're going to go. And when I was kind of writing this prompt myself, the first thing that I wrote down was actually tomatoes, which actually are my earrings, so tied to actually a memory before I was born, which is actually when my mother, when she was pregnant with me, only wanted to eat tomatoes. And so she actually had a garden in the yard that was only tomatoes, and she just ate those. There was something about baby Jane that really wanted tomatoes. And so I began the poem as a litany, but then it just turned into a poem about tomatoes and my relationship with my mother. So again, poetry, you don't know where it will take you. Sensory memories of food, you don't know where it will take you. It will take you towards that sweet, impossible blossom. I wanted to take a look at another poem that I love by a poet that I admire, Naomi Shihab Nye, and the poem is called The Traveling Onion. And I'll go ahead and screen share that too so that you're able to look at that poem. This is The Traveling Onion by Naomi Shihab Nye, and it begins with a quote, which I'll read as well. It is believed that the onion originally came from India. In Egypt, it was an object of worship. Why, I haven't been able to find out. From Egypt, the onion entered Greece and on to Italy, thence into all of Europe, Better Living Cookbook. When I think how far the onion has traveled just to enter my stew today, I could kneel and praise all small forgotten miracles. Crackly paper peeling on the drain board, pearly layers and smooth agreement, the way the knife enters onion and onion falls apart on the chopping block, a history revealed. And I would never scold the onion for causing tears. It is right that tears fall for something small and forgotten. How at meal we sit to eat, commenting on texture of meat or herbal aroma, but never on the translucence of onion, now limp, now divided, or as traditionally honorable career for the sake of others, disappear. This is also such a beautiful poem. And I think too, speaking about voltas or turns of unexpected nature, that by the end of the poem, there is this, you know, beautiful moment of for the sake of others disappear, and the sound of disappear in career always kind of gets me. But, you know, spending more time with this poem, it really raises questions about, you know, about what food means to you as a mode of honoring something or someone or a place. And there's something about the onion here. When it begins with "the onion has traveled just to enter my stew today," you can also read this poem as an ode or a poem that is meant to be celebratory, oftentimes of things that don't get enough celebration. In this case, the kind of the humble onion versus, right, the texture of meat or herbal aroma, that the onion here is at the central core of this meal, but yet it is something that disappears, right? And so I thought a lot about this poem and thinking about kind of writing odes and what we can do to kind of celebrate not only that which, you know, may not get necessarily as much attention in terms of the food that we love, but also thinking about how our food got to where we, you know, are looking at it, holding it, right? Thinking about the labor that went into picking this onion, of putting a seed into the soil, into, you know, where did this onion kind of arrive? At a grocery store, in a garden? Did a friend give this onion to you? So there's almost like a whole history of a journey as to how this onion arrived to where it is and what it means for you to kind of like be nourished by it. I love this tender moment of, "and I would never scold the onion for causing tears." What a gentle moment. And what I want us to do, kind of inspired by Naomi Shihab Nye's poem, is to take a moment to think about, you know, the kind of power of, you know, something as simple as an onion, and to transform something that may seem so humble, like a vegetable, into something quite magical and powerful, thinking about one's own histories, perhaps, or one's own kind of relationship to labor and the journeys we take as well. And so in this particular prompt, I want you to take a moment just to pause and go find a vegetable, quite literally. Maybe this vegetable is in your pantry or fridge, or maybe, you know, it is even just a twig of thyme or rosemary that you found taking a walk outside. But go find a vegetable. And this could be a fruit too. Fruits are all great as well. But I want you to take a few minutes with this vegetable and, you know, spend time with it, like hold it. I want you to think about, how does this vegetable feel in your hands? I'm thinking about that moment in Naomi's poem where there's this crackling paper peeling on the drain board. So how does this vegetable feel in your hands? How does it smell? Even to think about what sound does it make? And do you remember how you acquired this vegetable? Again, is this from a garden, from a grocery store, from a family member? What journey did this vegetable take? I want you to start with this writing prompt towards a poem as a ode, so a celebratory poem for this vegetable that you have. Inspired by her poem, I want you to begin imagining how this vegetable traveled to be here with you. And then after kind of thinking through that journey, what does this vegetable mean to you? Thinking about the ways in which you can weave in all of those sensory details, taste, touch, smell, sound, and sight, so that this poem has that kind of almost synesthesia feel to it, to kind of really create a celebratory ode. We'll pause and write for a little bit here. Welcome back again. I hope that you had some lovely writing time with your vegetable that you found. And I wonder too, kind of like what arose for you, especially at the end of this kind of piece. Well, you might not be finished with it quite yet, but thinking about the ways in which you, I guess, highlight or celebrate this vegetable that may be so deeply tied to your own kind of personal self and personal memories. The last piece I wanted to kind of like right through is actually an excerpt from a much larger piece or book. And this is actually the poet and writer Audre Lorde, who I deeply love. And this is from her book, Zami, which is actually a biomythography. And I want to kind of just read an excerpt from this section where Lorde is really thinking about the power of spices and of the mortar and pestle in thinking about memory and matrilineal lineage as well. And I'll just read a little bit for you all here, and then we can write a piece inspired by this deep love for the act of cooking or the rituals that are created in one's own family, in one's own kind of like chosen family too, of that kind of nourishment of what arises through ritual in particular. Again, this is Audre Lorde. After all the ingredients were in the bowl of the mortar, I fetched the pestle and placing it in the bowl, slowly rotated the shaft a few times, working it gently down to all the ingredients to mix them. Only then would I lift the pestle and with one hand firmly pressed around the carved side of the mortar, caressing the wooden fruit with my aromatic fingers, I thrust sharply downward, feeling the shifting salt and the hard little pellets of garlic right up through the shaft of the wooden pestle, up again, down, around, and up. So the rhythm began. The thud, push, rub, rotate, up, repeated over and over. The muted thump of the pestle on the bed of grinding spice as the salt and pepper absorb the slowly yielding juices of the garlic and celery leaves. Thud, push, rub, rotate, up, the mingling fragrances rising from the bowl of the mortar. Thud, push, rub, rotate, up. The feeling of the pestle held between my curving fingers and the mortar's outside rounding like fruit into my palm as I steadied it against my body. All these transported me into a world of scent and rhythm and movement and sound that grew more and more exciting as the ingredients liquefied. Sometimes my mother would look over at me with that amused annoyance which passed for tenderness. What you think you making there? Garlic soup? Enough, go get the meat now. And I would fetch the lamb hearts, for instance, from the icebox and begin to prepare them, cutting away the hardened veins at the top of the smooth, firm muscles. I divided each oval heart into four wedge-shaped pieces and taking a bit of the spicy mash from the mortar with my fingertips, I rubbed each piece with a savory mix, the pungent smell of garlic and onion and celery enveloping the kitchen. What I love about this excerpt, and I highly recommend reading the full book itself, is this kind of gentleness, this tenderness. Sometimes my mother would look over at me with that amused annoyance, which passed for tenderness. And that this ritual of, you know, grinding the spices through this mortar and pestle deeply ties Lord to her mother in a kind of way that can only be known, right, by Lord. It feels deeply personal, but it's also celebratory. There's something about the repetition, the sounds of the thud, push, rub, rotate up, that creates that kind of sonic memory coming forth. It's incredibly beautiful to read, even as this looks like something that could be prose, and it is written as prose, but for me, it definitely feels very lyrical and feels very much like a poem. So that in a way, there's a lot of hybridity here too, in thinking about what even is a poem, right? Like thinking about prose and poetry together, kind of intermingled in this way. And again, how this deeply kind of brings forth memories of matrilineal lineage and heritage and pride and joy in this moment of, you know, grinding spices together. And I wanted to kind of take a moment, inspired by Lord, to do our last writing exercise together, thinking about ritual. And that's so much about food, you know, is of course like, you know, enjoying eating it and the kind of sensory memories of it, but also the ways in which we eat. So the rituals that we prepare meals together, the ways in which we, you know, have little quirks within families as to who gets to kind of like mash up the garlic, right? And what are the steps you take to mash up that garlic? Who takes on that role in the family, right? And so there are these tiny little personal moments of ritual within a family. And in particular, for me, I was thinking a lot about this in terms of building an altar too, thinking about honoring my ancestors and my family members who have passed, and the rituals of preparing those altars, of putting the fresh oranges there, of pouring rice wine, and what that does to create that close connection. And in Lord's piece, how the mortar and pestle creates that connection with her mother in particular. So it's not just about the mortar and pestle, but it's about connection, about community, about lineage. And in this writing prompt, I would love for you to think about a ritual of yours related to cooking. Maybe you aren't, you know, a big cooker or someone who cooks a lot, but surely you've been around people who maybe have cooked a lot. And so I want you to think about these rituals of cooking and of connection. And I want you to think about one specific cooking ritual with someone that brings you comfort, that really brings us back to kind of what Liang Li was writing about in terms of that orchard within yourself. And I want you to describe this ritual of yours step by step, almost like you're creating an instruction manual of sorts, but yet this is going to be an instruction that has a lot of those kind of memories lyrically kind of woven in. Where does this ritual transport you, and how, in many ways, does this ritual deepen your relationship with this person? In Lord's piece with her mother, but how can these two kind of intermingle? The ritual of cooking something and also getting closer and closer with this person one is cooking with or preparing something with. And we'll kind of write for a little bit thinking about that ritual. I so badly want to kind of like read all of these things that you are writing with me, if only. but I welcome you to take another 10 minutes to write through these rituals of cooking. Okay, so we'll come back after writing that last spark together, inspired by Audre Lorde. And I wanted to kind of wrap up today thinking a little bit about you know, where to kind of move forward. Especially now, I feel like food has such a deep kind of personal resonance in a time where we need comfort. You know, I think that for me, as a poet, I've been struggling a lot writing creatively during this time. It's really hard to focus in many ways. And so what I've been doing actually I've been learning to cook more, and in particular, cook the food of my childhood to give myself some of that comfort. And so when I started cooking, you know, dishes like jok, which is a kind of a rice soup from my childhood, I felt almost ready to write after I kind of cooked something. And so in many ways, you know, cooking is a type of poetry, and I have a hard time kind of untangling the two from each other. I wanted to share with you, before we kind of end today, a list of suggested reading that you might want to check out if you're curious about the intersections of food and writing. I was lucky enough to teach a class at Western last spring, and I'll be teaching it again at Western this coming year on food writing. And we had such a beautiful journey of thinking about the social political implications of food justice, of nourishing our communities, of food as food as power and agency, food as memory and as healing, and so much more. So I want to share that list. And in this list, at the very bottom, you can see too, there's a link to an incredible collective called Tender Table, thinking about the ways in which food deeply impacts food identity and community. So I invite you to take a look at some of the past performances via Tender Table. And again, this is not an exhaustive list. I wish I could add even more. This is how much I could fit on this page so that you can see it on the screen. But there are some beautiful, beautiful pieces in here. It's poems, essays, even a comic is in here too, thinking about comics and graphic kind of novels, memoirs. So I just wanted to share that with you. I wanted to actually end today with maybe sharing a piece of my own in thinking about food and food writing. And I can leave you with like an extra prompt at the very end if you'd like to kind of continue writing these starts of poems. And I wanted to read this piece that was featured actually in the Frye Art Museum show. And the poem is called What is Love If Not Rot? But I feel like I needed to kind of like actually have some food with me. When I read this piece, I clearly ate the other half. I did not have this as a whole. I must have eaten it earlier today. I mentioned earlier that my family is so deeply tied to my thinking about food and writing because I grew up in a restaurant. My family also has a history of starvation as well, thinking about the Great Leap Forward, which occurred around 1958 to 1962, 1960, where an estimated 36 million people starved. This was a Maoist campaign. And it's a hard history for my family to talk about. My family doesn't speak about this time, and many families during this time don't speak about it. But I've been thinking a lot about, again, lineage and memory and the power of food in terms of unlocking these deeper kind of questions, these haunting questions about nourishing not just ourselves and our communities, but also our ancestors. And so I wanted to share this poem that I wrote called What is Love If Not Rot? Let me screen share it so that you're able to see the text itself. And in many ways, I kind of will promise my ancestors right after I read this poem, I will eat this grapefruit on their behalf, to almost like to feed them via feeding myself. So this is for them. What is love if not rot? I've been watching videos of rotting oranges on time lapse again. It's barely noticeable at first, The pores begin to grow, craters of no importance. After 14 days, the skin thins out, rice paper thin, wind thin, loneliness thin. At 15 days, spots bloom like a newborn galaxy or a bald buzzard circling, a shadow returning winter's wail. The skin puckers in on itself, all chimney ash, all brain matter mold. The middle, like touching a young organ, slobbering milk and mud, a pedestal of goldenrod flora at 17 days. At 20 days, moss lumbers up and through, continents growing along this orb, thickening at 22 days like cotton lint from the dryer, like fur, a sheepskin cloud, like my mother, an animal in her own right, expanding now the color phlegm yellow, pore yellow, growing smaller and smaller by 25 days, collapsing upon itself like curled fists, how I sleep at night, returning to heartbreak after heartbreak. Fruit flies fluttering about like snow. What is holding it up still? What is keeping it here? How can I bear to watch it? How can I liquefy by 45 days, wolfish in citrus murk? Ever shrinking, like every grandparent I've ever held hands with, at 85 days, how to hold this slush of glittering bees trapped in no worldly amber. And after kind of reading that poem, which I feel like I need to take a big breath after that, I was thinking of like an extra prompt if you kind of wanted to kind of think about, you know, kind of food waste too, and the ways in which there is so much food waste, and you know, what it means to be grateful, to be thankful for the food that you have in front of you. Maybe one could write a, you know, a poem inspired by, you know, this question of what it means to look at a piece of fruit rotting. What are the kind of questions that kind of murk underneath that or hum underneath that? You might actually start by literally watching. There's a ton of videos on YouTube actually of kind of, you know, fruit rotting or this kind of composting of food, and where that might lead you. For me, it led me towards this kind of question of, you know, what it means to value every single morsel of rice that I have, and to be grateful for all of that, since my family members didn't have that. And my mother herself, when she was born at the kind of start of the Cultural Revolution, would tell me that, you know, she would get like an egg on her birthday, and that she was, you know, so enamored by that one egg that she got, right? And so I now, whenever I, you know, have an egg, I really kind of hold that egg close to me as if it is almost a world unto its own. So all to say, thank you so much for writing with me today and listening. And I hope that you're able to spend some more time with those poems that I read for you. Again, the poets that I kind of walked us through today are Lee Young Lee, Naomi Shihab Nye, and Audre Lorde. And I welcome you to continue the pieces that you started today, and hopefully something of a feast will arise. Thank you again for being here, and thanks to the Seattle Public Library, a space very close to my heart as someone who grew up in public libraries. As I mentioned, I grew up in a restaurant, and so the library was across the street, so I'd spent all my time at the library. Love, love, love public libraries. Thank you, SPL, and thank you all for writing with me today. As we were all kind of writing deliciously. Sending much care and comfort to all. Thanks.